Short video on photomasks and the different types that you can find on the internet, for example on eBay. There's basically two different types. So first you have the contact masks, and second you have the projection masks. Now let's start with the contact masks. They're actually very thin plates of glass or quartz that have a chromium coating, and in this chromium coating there's a pattern etched. Now the way that you would use these masks is you would take a wafer, and on top of the wafer there is this photosensitive layer. You'd place the photomask on top of it, maybe align it first, and then you do a flood exposure from the top and transfer the pattern which is on the photomask in this way to the photosensitive layer on the wafer in a 1-to-1 ratio. Now, one of the problems with placing this in direct contact is the transfer of particles or even the generation of particles. So this is generally undesired. And another way that these masks are used is as proximity masks. So you would place this mask not in direct contact, but in close proximity with the photosensitive layer. Now the problem is then that due to diffraction effects on the edges of the mask, and due to the fact that a light beam is never perfectly collimated, the resolution would suffer from this. So moving the mask away from the wafer would actually lead to a lower resolution. Now the second type of mask is the projection mask. And what you can see is immediately that this mask is quite a lot thicker. So it's actually a thick quartz plate, and it contains the chip pattern in this case. It actually contains 6 chips. The resolution of this mask is actually mind-boggling. If you look at the features on this mask, there's actually features that are submicron. The mask is from 2008, so at that time they already made features of 100 nanometers on chips. So this means that it's actually quite an advanced mask. Now, one of the things is that when they're finished with productions, these masks are generally destroyed. However, this one somehow managed to survive that process. I don't know how. And it was sold on eBay, I think, for about $40 or so. It contains a very nice pattern of one of the layers of a chip. And there's also another feature about this mask. If you look carefully, there's actually this thing on top of it, and it's called the pellicle. Now, a pellicle is actually just a very thin layer, a very thin foil, which is away from the actual pattern surface or the mask surface. And the way they, the reason why they do this is actually to keep particles away from the mask pattern. Now you can imagine that if a particle lands on the pattern, this would immediately lead to a defect in the chip. But if you have a pellicle on top of that, then the particle would not land on the pattern, but it would land on the pellicle. So it would be like 6 millimeters away from the surface of the chromium where you have the pattern. And in this way, when you do a projection, the particle is out of focus, and so it's not visible, and it will not generally lead to a defect unless it's of course a very, very big particle. Now the same is of course true on the other side, because this layer of quartz is so thick, any particles that get to this side also are not close to the actual chip pattern, so they will not immediately lead to a defect. The main reason that I bought these masks is actually for fun, just to have a look at the patterns and maybe do some experiments on them. An additional thing is that the proximity masks are actually often made of quartz, and quartz is a very nice material. Quartz has many unique properties, such as a very high melting point, it's chemically inert, it's optically transparent in the deep UV, so it is a very nice material to work with. And you can, for example, make optical windows out of it. But of course, first you have to remove the chromium layer, which is easier said than done, because the chromium is a very tough material to remove. Now, I found several recipes for etching chromium, and only a few of them work. So what I will do is, in this video, also show you how to remove chromium in order to make a clear quartz plate out of an old photomask. The rest of this video is on etching chromium from photomasks. Now, before you start doing this yourself, Let me state for the record that there is no such thing as a harmless chromium etchant. And don't attempt this unless you have some background in chemistry. Keep your safety goggles on and use protective gloves. And if you're finished, do not dispose the used etchant by just flushing it down the drain, because chromium salts are extremely poisonous and dangerous to the environment, so dispose of them as chemical waste. The fumes of the concentrated nitric acid, which we're going to use, are unpleasant to inhale, to say the least. One option would be to do the preparations and the etching outside. Ideally, you would have a fume cupboard to work in, but most people don't have one. I actually made one myself from a large storage container. And what I did was cut out one side of the container and use the lid as the bottom of the workspace. On the back of the container, I added an exhaust pipe, which I could connect to the ventilation exhaust of my workshop. I also added a few ceramic floor tiles to the bottom of the container, just to prevent hot things from melting into the bottom of the box. It actually works very well, and the part that I cut out was used to keep the opening of the box closed as much as possible in order to keep the fumes inside. The best chromium etchant you can work with is a solution of ceric ammonium nitrate and nitric acid. The concentrations, which I indicated here, are not very critical for your application, because it's just removing chromium from the photomask. So a higher concentration of these components works just as well or even better. If you want to control the etching rate, the concentrations are of course critical. The nice thing about this solution is that it also works on old masks, which might have a thick layer of chromium oxide. The difficult component to acquire could be the cerium ammonium nitrate, which is not widely available. I couldn't find a cheap supplier here in the Netherlands, so I used a trick to make it myself. The material that I did have in my workshop was cerium oxide, which is dead cheap and also widely available as a polishing agent for glass. I added a few grams of cerium oxide to a concentrated solution of nitric acid, about 53%. Now, the cerium oxide does not immediately react with the nitric acid. However, if you heat the solution to 60 or 80 degrees Celsius, it will react to cerium nitrate in a few hours. And you can see this because the solution will turn brightly orange. Next is to let the remaining cerium oxide precipitate to the bottom and remove the clear cerium nitrate solution from the vial. It can be as concentrated as 15%, but it can also be less. But it also contains a large amount of nitric acid. The next thing you do is add some concentrated ammonium solution. Now be careful, this is adding a strong base to a very strong acid. So you should do this in a controlled way and stir the whole time. Make sure the solution is still strongly acidic after you've added the ammonium. So it should stay a bright orange after you've added it. The etchant is now ready for use and will etch 100 nanometer layers of chromium in a matter of minutes at room temperature. After finishing, remove the quartz plate and put it into clear water to rinse it and remove the acid solution. Okay, so this is the way you can remove chromium from old photomasks. I hope the information in this video was useful to you, and hopefully see you in the next video, which will be about photolithography, and I will also use the same process to etch micron-sized features in chromium masks.